Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Backlot Banter. My name is Tucker Hazel. Today, I'm joined by my bloody sweet co-host, Tanner Dykstra. We're here to talk about Winnie the Pooh, Blood and Honey 2. We reviewed the first film last year and didn't like it at all. That was a really bad movie.
Bad movie.
The Poonaverse seems to be here to stay.
That's right.
Our good boy, what's his name, director name?
Reese Scott Wakefield.
No, Reese Frake Waterfield.
Oh, whatever. I don't know.
You got him mixed up. Reese Frake Waterfield is here pumping out these classic horror films, and we have viewed Winnie the Pooh, Blood and Honey 2. But if you want to talk to us about this film, about the upcoming Bambi and Peter Pan and Pinocchio and Blood and Honey 3 and Poonaverse. There's all sorts of stuff to talk about. You can join our Discord and link in the description. And you can also leave a comment talking about this movie versus the first one if you're interested in any of the upcoming ones. But Tanner,
yeah,
we watched the movie.
True.
I would say you were apprehensive to go into this.
That's right. I was. But then, Tucker, a little something happened. This film debuted to 100% on Rotten Tomatoes.
It did.
Quickly fell to around 53.
Now, to be fair, it debuted with 100% with like 20 reviews, which is insignificant.
It was
like
six.
Oh, that's right. It got 20.
Yes. But hey, that is 50% higher than the first film's 3% on Rotten Tomatoes. So I tried to keep an open mind going into this.
Yeah.
I tried to keep an open mind after, you know, looking through some of those positive reviews that compared it to, you know, slasher movies of year old, that are, you know, sort of just there to just deliver kills to you in a certain sense, and be sort of trashy and just sort of entertaining.
Yeah.
So, to that extent, I did enjoy Winnie the Pooh, Blood and Honey 2 more.
Yeah.
I still think it is a poor film.
Sure.
And we can get into all the reasons that I think that. But I think I have eased into the idea of the twisted childhood cinematic universe and the things that it is doing.
Yeah, I didn't like the first movie.
Uh-huh.
But I had a weird twisted childhood respect for it.
Oh.
Where I was like, I like that they're doing this because why the fuck not? Someone's got to, and now I've seen it.
Mm-hmm.
And now it's becoming an actual thing. And also you can see that this creative team is growing their chops, not only through a bigger budget, but just through more experience, hiring better actors. This is a vastly, vastly superior film. I leaned over to you a couple times and I'm like, wow, this movie has like a screenplay.
Well,
and like actors.
Yeah.
And like there's like a story going on here. And I'm like, which is a very, very low bar to set.
Of course.
But it's
one that the first movie did not really clear.
No, it didn't clear. And so, by comparison, this is an amazing, amazing movie. It's not an amazing movie, based on other standards. But I still think it is a fine horror movie. And very impressive for an incredibly, incredibly low budget.
Half a million dollars
went into this. And it doesn't look that cheap. This is a decently lit, decently shot.
I want to get into the lighting.
Okay,
I want to get into that.
I think this is a decently made movie with some impressive camera movements and decent like set design in the background stuff. I'm like, they did a really good job for $500,000 here. So I am just, I'm happy with this movie as a big improvement and as a solid low budget horror movie.
Sure. Okay. So it's like, where do we want to start here? We want to start with the story, the screenplay, as you put it, the first one of these to have one.
There's a screenplay in this movie.
Yeah, so the story, and do we want to say spoilers for Winnie the Pooh, Blood and Honey? Spoilers for Winnie the Pooh, Blood and Honey 2. I feel like this is not one that people are on the fence about going to see.
Well, also, it's already out of theaters.
That's true. We saw it on the last day it's in theaters. Anywho, so the story here is that we pick up, you know, obviously after the events of the first film.
Obviously.
Yeah. Christopher Robin has been sort of blamed for the events that went down in the 100 Acre Wood in the first
100 Acre Massacre.
The 100 Acre Massacre. But also like some people are just like, I bet he did it, and some people are like, I don't think he did.
Yeah.
And there doesn't seem to be any police investigation or anything to that effect.
No. But well, I think they already went through that. I think that was between the films.
But that's just sort of an underlying
tension
that lies within the town.
In Ashfield.
Ashton?
Ashwood. Like
And then there's also a group of like, there's also a contingent of the population who are like hunting the animals.
Yes, yes.
We see three guys do that.
Yeah.
So anyway, Winnie the Pooh, and we now get introduced to Owl, and Piglet is there for a moment.
Yeah, then gets shot in the head and dies like a bitch.
And Tigger.
Yeah.
They're like, we gotta take the fight to them.
Yeah.
That we gotta take the fight to the people of Ashtown, Asheville, whatever it's called.
Yeah.
And so they do. And so that's just, at a certain point we just get into the moment where it's just them going around and killing people. Of course, the underlying plot with the twist is that these creatures are experiments from when they were children. And in fact, Winnie the Pooh is Christopher Robin's brother who was abducted as a child and experimented on.
Yeah.
And I think that's as much of a twist as we get, right?
That is as much of a twist, but I do actually really appreciate both of these elements. I think that the town turning against Christopher Robin and people not trusting him and he's getting kicked out of his job because it's like a big scandal and different people around him like react differently, like, oh, he might be a murderer. Like, I don't know if I want to have him come to my party. And his family's trying to support him and his car's getting graffitied. I think that is a much stronger thrust into a narrative for a main character.
Than people wandering into the woods.
Then your average slasher movie where it's just like podunk random characters I don't really give a fuck about. Christopher Robin is a character with conflict and like worries in this movie. And I actually think that that's just an interesting way into a film. And I've always thought about what happens the day after a slasher movie. Like what going into the investigation of these things, the survivors, the guilt, the trauma. This movie doesn't play with that fully, but it certainly incorporates those ideas of people thinking that he did it, not believing that there were these monsters in the woods, him going to therapy for these things. I think that that is a very interesting part of this screenplay that I really enjoy.
I suppose it's probably just a symptom of them not having the production budget for an expanded cast, like to get a town's worth of people. Because who do you really get that plays into that, that dynamic? You get the girl who's going to have the party who's like, I don't want him at my party. And then you get his parents who believe him. And then his girlfriend who believes him. And the boss in half a scene that says, hey, you're fired. So,
but they're always talking about it, which I think makes it feel omnipresent. This is a low budget movie. We're only in a couple of different locations. But I think that through the script and the actions of the people around him that are always talking about this, and he's going to therapy for it. I think it does make it feel like a consistent part of it.
I do want to give credit where credit is due. Scott Chambers is good in this movie.
He is good in this movie.
He is much better than the initial actor whose name I will pull up. And before they started this movie, they played like a highlight reel of the first film. And so I got a couple of line readings from the fine gentleman. Where is he? Nikolai Leon. I was like, ooh. This guy was not very good in that first movie. Just jog my memory a little bit. This new guy is good.
I mean,
he has a lot more to do rather than just like being captured and crying and screaming. He has some emotions to convey. He has to be personable to his parents and to his little sister and so forth.
And he is very personable. I think that I'm sorry, I forgot the actor's name already. But I think that he does actually a really good job. I mean, there's just some moments where we're looking at him like he's like thinking about something and his face is moving like that. Like this guy's actually acting. And he makes an endearing, compelling main character because you see him going through these things and worrying about the trauma that he's going through and being confused and stressed and, but still like loving his sister and being worried for his sister. I'm like, this guy's selling it.
I think he's not exactly a scream queen though, because there comes the moment, especially when we get to the third act where he's just looking at a lot of dead bodies. It kind of starts when that one guy kills himself in front of him. And Scott Chambers, you know, I have never acted in the theatrically distributed film before, but a lot of times his reaction to seeing someone either kill themselves or just seeing a dead masked body is just
there's a lot of covering his mouth.
Do with that what you will. That's just something that I noticed.
But I also do want to get back to the other plot element that I thought raises this above in terms of an interesting screenplay. I do think that including the backstory for the animals is interesting. I mean, the fact that the kids were kidnapped and then experimented on, they like lived on their own in the woods for all this time. I actually thought that the story that I, from what I remember of the first film, is that these were just creatures that lived out there. And of course, that's like maybe just like fairy tale aspect of it. But I think grounding it a little bit more in this history and personally connecting it to Christopher Robin makes it feel a lot more cohesive. And like this movie has its own idea rather than these are just the characters living out in the woods. Because that's what
that's a good point.
Because Winnie the Pooh and his friends in the original story are just characters living out in the woods. No, this film has a reason why
there's he's a little fucked lore, up, the little background.
And I really do appreciate the effort that went into creating that. I don't think that it's played all the way through. There are like some elements where I'm like, well, why didn't we learn a little bit more about this? But I mean, it's just because this is a quick, low budget movie.
It's like I think ultimately it's like 85 or 95 minutes about. Tucker, should we just get to the murderous aspect of it, the animals and so forth? So, one thing I did ask you when we were sitting in our other movie of last night, Godzilla X Kong, yes, which we'll get to.
So, you're talking about Winnie the Pooh, Blood and Honey 2, while we were watching that movie.
Is that I asked you which of the, because they changed the design of Winnie the Pooh, and also Piglet, but he's not in like any of the movie.
No, you barely see his mask at all, yeah.
So, they changed the design to be more intricate, yes, I would say, you know, sort of
more believable,
more haggard and stuff like that. More, there's more fur on it rather than just like a plasticky looking mask.
Yeah,
and I appreciate it from that aspect. You know, they upgraded a little bit. You know, you can see the actor's eyes more and so forth.
It feels less mechanical.
It feels less mechanical, but I also find that first one creepier because it is mechanical.
No, totally.
I don't really know what the balance is here for me.
I think that both are good in their own way.
Yeah.
I think that the Pooh mask of the first one and that character design was the best part about that movie. Mm. I'm like, that's a good design, and they made a really good-looking mask.
Yep.
And even though it was kind of mechanical, like there was like emoting underneath the mask and stuff, I think that design is more distinct, mm-hmm, because it has this cartoony, like grotesque thing going
ultimately
on.
Ultimately, if you especially for a lot of this movie that is quite underlit, you're like, if you're showing Tigger versus Pooh, you're like, which one is that? Oh, okay, that's Pooh. They become more samey.
But I do think that for what this movie is going for, this is the better design.
I think so.
This is a grounded half human, half bear, like more believable, like fur and skin texture.
Mm-hmm.
That, like, looking back at the other one, I'm like, that couldn't be a real thing.
No, its face moves about in this much of a range, like that. The kills and stuff like that. One thing I heard about going into this is that they really crank up the number of them,
mm-hmm,
and you know, obviously you get your cold open with them murdering some like nondescript teens or whatever. But I also felt like there was moments, quite long moments of downtime where we weren't getting that.
Oh, that's definitely true.
I was expecting more of a rampage, and you don't get that till the end.
Yeah.
And here's what I'll say about it. So they crank up the idyllic scale of the kills.
Yes.
They kill a building's worth, like a rave's worth of people.
Yeah.
But a lot of them are very quick.
Yes,
multiple
yes.
of them, big groups of them are off screen.
Yeah.
So you only get a couple ones, and only a handful of those are memorable ones, I would say.
Well, here's the thing about the kills in this movie.
Yeah.
Is I think that it's of two streets.
I
think that the ones that they put effort into with practical effects and makeup that's like people's faces completely messed up,
mm-hmm,
I think that those are done well. I think the practical effects are really, really good in this.
Yeah.
Someone's arm breaking off
and
their face melting because they were shot or whatever. I'm like,
mm-hmm,
they did a really good job there. There are a few that are memorable. I think probably the best one of these two movies is when Pooh throws a bear trap at someone. It grabs their head and he rips it and the head just goes flying off. I'm like, that was really well done,
mm-hmm,
and really cool. And it's in its rave sequence. So there's like lights flashing back.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, that is, I think, probably the only great kill in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think there are some good ones. I think the practical effects are actually really, really good.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that it's obvious that this is a low-budget horror movie.
Yes.
In that we get a lot of cutting away.
Yeah.
We get a lot of just, like, blood squirting out of a thing off-screen,
mm-hmm,
or, like, blood dripping off a thing. And I'm of the mind of, in order to achieve what this movie is going for on the budget that it has,
mm-hmm,
that's necessary to do.
That's
like
fair.
This would need to be a double the budget movie in order to show all these kills in gruesome detail.
Yeah, for me, it's like, I think there's a happy medium where like you don't need to have the idea of like Pooh murdering, you know, Pooh and Tigger murdering like 3 dozen people.
Yeah, yeah.
You can scale it back and, you know, make it more of a classic thing like the first movie where you just have like a cabin's worth of people where you can put more effort into each one potentially.
Yeah.
But, you know, I digress. I digress.
Yeah.
Obviously, you want to crank up the sort of scale with the sequel.
And I think it works for that.
As these films get bigger and bigger budgets, I'm sure that we'll see more
and more
stuff like that.
But I think it is a good sign of what's to come because, I think that the ones that they do put effort into are well done, especially
mm-hmm,
for as low of a budget as it has.
Yeah.
I found myself being impressed by the practical effects and a couple of the kills quite consistently.
Yeah, that's a fair point. I think that's kind of my main thing is that... So obviously you see Pooh with a number of these kills, but you also we also get some expanded, you know, a cast here of monsters with Owl, who doesn't really do a lot of killing in the latter half of the film.
Yeah.
The film seems to forget about Owl largely in that latter half. And Tigger, who's really only let loose in that latter half.
Correct, yeah. I mean, he's almost not involved in the first half at all. And then Piglet is dead by that point.
Right.
Yeah, I think that the balancing of those three, because it's not really four, mm-hmm. of the three monsters is a little bit weird. I like that Al is a consistent presence throughout the film. He's always gliding between mm-hmm. the trees and like, hiding up on the...
He can talk, which Pooh cannot.
Yes, yes.
So that's an important
thing.
And
so he's like, kind of like a mastermind yeah. behind all this. And Tigger can also talk.
Tigger can also talk, but he's more like, they like lock him up. And Owl obviously playing on the thing from the original like childhood story where he's like the smart one yeah, planning yeah. things. Yeah, yeah,
yeah. And so I think that the balance between them dynamic wise is pretty good. Like they have different personalities. I like that Tigger, Pooh likes to use weapons. Tigger just likes to slash the shit out of people.
Yeah, yeah.
Just like, I mean, frankly, it goes on a little too long. But every time he does a kill, it's like 45 seconds worth of him going, and everyone going, but like they do feel different. But also, because this movie is so Christopher Robin heavy,
yeah.
it's about his narrative, about him mm-hmm. going to therapy and his relationship with his girlfriend, his parents and all that, and the town. I do think that the actual monsters get very backgrounded.
They do.
We learn about them
in a circumspect way.
Through the lore that Christopher Robin comes to learn. Right. But we never really spend too much time with the monsters. Mm-hmm. Like, what is their dynamic? I mean, they talk about how they're it's kind of like deforestation, where like their habitat is growing smaller, which is an interesting idea, but it's not really played into.
Exactly. I mentioned that at the beginning, where like they say that like, oh, and also there's some people who are hunting down the monsters
and destroying the forest.
And by that I mean there are three people who get dispatched very quickly. Yes. By Owl and Tigger and Pooh. One of them survives and has like a crazy melty face effect on him, which is pretty cool. But I did notice that they clearly only had that prosthetic that looks good from one angle.
Sure.
Because when we cut to like the janitor looking in at the window or whatever, there's conveniently like a big black box covering guy's head.
Of course, yeah.
So yeah, anyway. I want to talk about the kill scenes as well. Because they are quite disjointed.
Yeah.
There is a lot of like, where is this character going? Yeah. Where do they just come from? How much time all happening in one night? And our characters just seemingly teleport between different houses and buildings.
Yeah. Absolutely, yeah. Because Pooh is basically everywhere.
He's everywhere.
This movie. And I'm like, okay, this is a small British town.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's reasonable for a character that is strong and maybe fast, I don't really know, to like get places. But we do some like hard cuts and he's somewhere else. I'm like, yeah, okay.
Okay, fine, yeah. Sure. They just shot this scene and they're like, I don't know, just drop it somewhere in the edit.
Yeah, definitely. But yeah, I think this is an okay horror movie.
Mm-hmm.
And that is very impressive coming from the team that made Winnie the Pooh, Blood and Honey.
Yeah. Yeah, but here's my thing about it. And, you know, this is more of an overview thing.
Sure.
We are in sort of like a renaissance of low budget horror, sure. I would say. You know, there's a number of films that have come out that have gotten, you know, high acclaim that I have not seen, mm-hmm. To be fair. Things like Stop Motion came out this year.
I've never heard of that.
Which is about like a animator being killed by their stop motion creations.
Cool.
It's a really cool idea. Again, small budget. We have something like, what's the one that's from the killer's perspective or whatever?
I have no idea what's
That one's a big festival hit.
Yeah.
Another low budget one that is apparently getting rave reviews. Like, you can make a really solid horror movie on a low budget.
Yeah.
And these guys seem to be consistently raising the bar, but they're also aiming for something quite different.
Yeah.
They're aiming for something a little bit more tongue in cheek, a little bit more twisted, if you will.
And I do want to cover in one other area. I do think that the fact that the animals have dumb quips is really leaning into the bit here.
One of the cops says, oh, let's bounce. And then Tigger says, that's my line.
Yeah, that's a good moment. When Pooh gets shot in the head at the end, he goes, oh, bother. And then his head explodes. And I'm like, look,
I think they should do more of that.
Yeah.
I think we should lean more into that and maybe lean away from like, and what if they were real and killed people? Like, you could have them murder people.
Yeah.
I think you just raise the cartooniness a little bit. And I'm on, like, those are the only moments of the film that I was, like, genuinely enjoying.
Sure.
I was like, that's funny. I like that.
Yeah. I like the fact that Owl leaves owl pellets in
that guy's house. Exactly. Like, if you raise the
Tigger never bounces, which I think is a missed opportunity.
That's a missed opportunity. Get some wire work in there. But I think you raise the ceiling of allowing these characters to be a little bit more heightened. I think that you can also raise the cartooniness of the kills in that fashion.
Sure.
Because ultimately, the kills and everything like this are they're quite gruesome, they're quite harrowing, when in fact they could be more silly and goofy,
sure.
I think.
That's definitely true.
Yeah.
But we'll have a lot of time to find out, because this creative team is apparently just getting started.
Yeah.
It'll be interesting to see if this the audience for this is able to grow. I think that one thing that I can see working against this is that this movie made for a much bigger budget than the other one, still obviously very small budget, but only in theaters for 3 days, I think is a little bit of a, I mean, maybe that's just all they can get or they can afford or
from,
whatever.
From an anecdotal standpoint, there were more people in the theater than there were for Winnie the Pooh, Blood and Honey 1. Yes. So I think the influence is growing here. The range is growing
here. By the time we get to Pooniverse in late 2025.
It's going
to
be endgame level crowds.
Yes. But even though this is not an amazing movie, I say good on you, Rhys Frake Waterfield, and the guy who plays Christopher Robin, that is also apparently the one directing Bambi.
Scott Chambers.
Or not Bambi, he's directing Peter Pan?
He's directing
Peter Pan. Yeah.
And Pinocchio. Both of them are doing Pinocchio.
I want to support these guys who are just making feature films on a small budget and having a good time doing it.
Yeah, like I think it, for me, it really benefited from having the little thing at the beginning. Hey, we're the directors. They're just on a Zoom call in their office or whatever. It's like, here's all the movies that we want to we are planning on making, rather. And from that standpoint, I was like, I can relate to this a little bit more. I can dig what these guys are doing a little bit more. And, you know, that certainly helped me going into the film, I think, as well.
Totally.
I'm still going to give this one like a 3.5 out of 10.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's pretty low. I'm going to go higher. I'm going to go above 5.
Okay.
Which means slightly above average. I'm going to go with a 5.6. I think this is a solid movie. I am usually pretty generous towards horror movies just because I find the experience enjoyable. And I think that this one also just surpassed my expectations.
Mm-hmm.
Frankly, I was watching this movie like, that's an actor doing acting.
Mm-hmm.
And like the direction is like, okay, like there's some like cutbacks between things and like sometimes an interesting shot composition. I'm like, hey, you really upped your game here.
Yeah.
And that I think added to my enjoyment. I was like surprised and like delighted by the fact that it was actually solidly made.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, it's an okay movie. Unfortunately, you can't go see it because it's already out of theaters.
And it'll be on VOD probably pretty quickly.
Yes. Yes. But you will get, if you watch this and you, what we said sounded interesting, there are apparently like 2 more of these coming out this year.
And then more going into production next year.
Yes.
And so, yeah. You know, we'll be getting plenty of these.
Yes. And we will be here to talk about them because I think this is an interesting part
of
the current cinematic landscape.
I would agree.
But thank you very much for watching, everyone. We will see you for Bambi, The Reckoning.
No more movie reviews until then.